writers and money. They asked me tonight to talk a bit about, the theme was playing with matches. We're all supposed to talk about something to do with playing with matches, which they may have meant literally, but I assume they meant some dangerous thing you've done in life that you've somehow survived, the equivalent of playing with matches. And for me, the story I immediately thought of was the single most difficult and dangerous thing I've ever had to do, which was to deliver a keynote speech to a conference at 8 a.m. one Saturday morning that I had found out about at 11:30 the night before. Because I make a little bit of my living talking. When I arrived in New York 33 years ago, even when I couldn't make any money writing, I could make a little bit of money talking. And those of us who make some part of our living talking are in a different relationship to talking, I think, than other people are. I know that many people find talking and talking in public stressful, and we find it stressful too, but it's a kind of stress that you have to turn into an occupation, a vocation. It's a very strange thing when you start to do that. The first job I ever had in New York was giving what were called gallery lectures at the old Museum of Modern Art, the old building. And you would do them every day from 12 noon. And you'd have to park yourself in front of a famous painting, The Starry Night or The Demoiselle d'Avignon. And you would start talking like a crazy person and hope that you drew a crowd. And fortunately, my family comes from a long line of boardwalk barkers in Atlantic City. And my uncle Sam would do the same thing with a kind of starch that he was trying to sell. Start ironing and hope that people collect. And I would start talking about Van Gogh and hope that people would come around. And over the weeks and the months, you would begin to collect regulars and a crowd, and you learn that you could hold people to some degree just with the sound of your voice. And then you go on, and you sort of enter, you find out that talking, this is in the days 30 years ago when there weren't TED Talks, and of course there was no internet, there was sort of no hierarchy of talking, there was sort of no A-League you could enter and work your way up finally to the show. You just sort of had to stand there and start talking and hope that people would pass you money. And I found myself on sort of the minor leagues, going from Richmond to Akron and from Akron to Indianapolis, talking about bad art in awkward homes, and slowly trying to build up a reputation as a speaker so I could start making some money. One Friday night, I was at home, this is in about 1990, and the phone rang. And I picked it up, and on the other end of the line was someone who introduced himself, and I'll say his name was Ben Nathan. He said, "Hello, Adam, this is Ben Nathan calling." I said, "Hi, Ben." And he said, "We're all so looking forward to your keynote tomorrow morning at the Pluralism and Individualism Conference." Now, I'm a somewhat disorganized person, highly disorganized person, and it didn't shock me that I would have agreed to give the keynote at the Pluralism and Individualism Conference on a Saturday morning 6 months before and have totally forgotten about it. But it did surprise me, and I couldn't remember what the conference was about. Fortunately, he helped me right away. He said, "I wanted to call you. We're expecting you at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning, and I'll be waiting outside the hotel for you." And he said, "What we were all wondering about after the first day of the conference, looking forward to your keynote, was, were you planning to emphasize pluralism, or were you going to emphasize individualism instead?" And I said, "You know, I was actually going to try and do a kind of medley of the two together." And he said, "Oh," he said, "that's very reassuring. That's what we were hoping you would do." And so then I said, "You know, I'm so looking forward to it, and I've been preparing for the last few weeks about it, but let me make sure that I have here on my card for tomorrow morning exactly where I'm supposed to be and exactly who I'm supposed to address. I just want to be precise. I want to cross every T and dot every I." And he said, "The Midtown Hotel, Lexington and 50th, where it was going to be in the ballroom, and he said, and of course, you know, it's the Pluralism and Individualism Conference. All right. So I went to sleep and I set my alarm. Now, you have to understand to get the full aura of what happened, that this is in the years before my wife and I had children at all. And before you have children, people say that what really changes when you have children is having sex, but that's not really true. What really changes is sleep. You never sleep again after you have children the way you do before you have children. There's a quality of absolute concentration to your sleep. Hours and hours go on. And then after you have children, it becomes impossible to ever sleep again. All of your wiring gets remade and you wake up at every hour when your small children ever woke up before, 3:30, 4:30, 5:30. You're on a perpetual short fuse for the rest of your life. But in those days, we could sleep for 10 hours, 11 hours at a stretch with great focus and happiness and concentration. And that's what leaches out of your life afterwards. So I had to set the alarm. I knew my wife would sleep through it, and I had my little gray suit, the only suit I owned, ready to go. And the alarm goes off at 7 o'clock. I shower and I shave, and I put on my gray suit, and I get on the subway, and I go up to the 51st Street subway, and I step out, and there's the hotel, exactly, and there's the man greeting me. And he brings me in, and he says, "Everyone is waiting for you." And I walked into this ballroom, this immense ballroom, and I thought, well, I'll figure it out as soon as I'm in there. I'll figure it out. Are these Scientologists? Are they Moonies? Who are they? And I see instead an immense ballroom filled with extremely well-dressed people at 8:30 in the morning, every man in a shirt and tie, every woman in a skirt and a blazer, and a giant banner that says Pluralism and Individualism, 1990. And that's the totality of the information that I have. And I got up and I gave a keynote address about pluralism and individualism, which is still one of my finest public speeches. Because I discussed pluralism in all of its implications and all of its possibilities. I discussed variety. I discussed choice. I discussed range. I discussed the panoply of possibilities that life presents us with, and then I skillfully crossed over and began talking about individualism in all of the ways that can affect us, the individual person, the individual meal, the individual event. And then I proposed, having fully opened the subject of pluralism and peeked at the subject of individualism, all of the vital ways in which these two concepts could cross-fertilize and hybridize and bring us wisdom. Absolute silence, and when I had finally finished my keynote, there was first stillness and then warm applause from every corner. And as I stepped down from the stage, my host greeted me and he took me outside and he said, "Thank you, that was very healing." And he put an envelope in my pocket, and I got back on the subway and I went back to our little loft in Soho, and my wife was still sound asleep on the bed. And I took off my suit, and I got undressed, and I got back into bed and fell back asleep. Now, I don't actually think it was a dream, though from that day to this, I still have no idea who the pluralists and individualists were, why they wanted me, what caused them to meet in 1990, or what it was that I told them that healed the problem that they had. But I did learn this. I did learn this. And that is, if you are thinking of starting a life as a speaker, trying to make some part of your living as a young writer, as a talker, the crucial thing to understand is every talk you will ever give, every speech you will ever offer, will be about pluralism and individualism. When you do your TED talk, you will be talking about how your experience suddenly got fit into a brand new frame by something that happened before you put the Madonna mic on. You'll be talking about pluralism and individualism. If you give a series of lectures in Canada, you'll be talking about the role of the individual Canadian against the great Canadian collectivity. If you go to France and you give a talk about Impressionism, you'll be talking about the role of the individual Impressionist against the plurality of Impressionism proper. Every lecture you will ever give in your life will be the keynote address at 8:30 a.m. to the mysterious crowd at the Pluralism and Individualism Conference. So in that sense, though, I'm pretty sure that it wasn't actually a dream. I'm absolutely convinced that it was a vision. Thank you so much.